Hello and thank you so much. This far, we've enjoyed your company on Good Morning Kenya, and we trust that we shall continue riding on the same all the way to 9 a.m. We do hope you're making your morning worth your while. My name is Samuel Njoroge. Thank you so much for keeping Safina Chieng company throughout the first part of the interview. And now it's time for us to look into other matters that are actually literally forming headlines, because if you were to look at the dailies this morning, the Standard talks about the slum upgrading project. We shall be talking about that this morning, among a host of other issues, because we are privileged to host the Principal Secretary for Lands and Urban Development, Architect Aida Munano, is with us in studio this morning. Welcome to the program.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And it's a pleasure to have you on Good Morning Kenya to shed light on a couple of issues. Probably we can just start off with, before we even get into all the other stuff, how are you fitting into the ministry? How is it taking you this far?
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
As I'm in the ministry, I'm right where I actually belong, because this is an area where I've worked. I have quite a bit of experience in this. It's an area I've worked on building infrastructure, construction infrastructure. So I'm at home, and I believe I'm on top of things as I take up my duties.
Right.
Yes.
There has been a concern about the rapid urbanization of our cities, keen point even right here in Nairobi. And at times people wonder, does the space and the setup really, you know, support this kind of growth rapidly?
Okay, thank you very much. You know, urbanization is actually the buzzword internationally. Mm. Even right now with Habitat 3,
yes,
which will take place in Ecuador in October, the theme for Habitat 3 is actually human settlements and urbanization. And we are totally in step, even as the Ministry of Land, Housing and Urban Development, and specifically in the State Department of Housing and Urban Development. Yes, indeed, we are in step. We do appreciate that right now we are at 34% of urbanization, and we are working towards, we know, from the, if we continue the trend that we have now, by 2030, we'll be at around 50%. And we really need to take care of this. We need to be very, very proactive and make sure that we are ready as urbanization continues. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And as the growth happens, as you rightfully put it, Aida, this morning, there is one reality we cannot run away from. Statistics indicate that 75% of people living, for example, in Nairobi are in slums. So, talking about 3 million people.
Mm-hmm.
And someone may wonder, even as we grow, even as we hit the levels that we want to take our cities to, what is government doing to ensure that, you know, our cities do not degenerate into, you know, a jungle of what we may call a limitless jungle of informal settlements?
Again, I want to confirm to you that the government is on top of things on this particular one. And one of the ways of addressing any of such challenges is to actually first and foremost deal with policy and then deal with legislation, so that can guide the implementation of any programs that you have. Mm-hmm. In terms of policies, The other day we had a supplementary in the media when we were having a cross consultations for the National Urban Development Plan. And from the consultations that we got, we have updated the document, continuously consulting with the county government, because we need to note that as we move on in the national government, we need to move along with the county government. So now the document, we had this on the 17th of February. We've had our consultations further, we've had retreats and all, and now we have a document ready, and we are forwarding this document, the National Urban Development Plans. We are, the policy, not the plan, we are forwarding that to the cabinet, And one thing, because it's all a government program.
Yes.
Anytime we have forwarded policies, legislation to cabinet, because we are really moving as one government, there is always fast tracking of all of this. So we are confident that by the close of the year, we'll actually have the national urban development plans policy in place.
Right.
In addition to that, we are working with the counties developing integrated strategic urban development plans so that that too can guide the urbanization process, and anything we develop should be guided by that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but we really need the support of the people of this country and also the support of the county governments, because most of the implementation of these development plans will be undertaken by the county government. So enforcement, compliance by the people, enforcement by the county governments is absolutely necessary.
Right.
So that's the direction we are taking in terms of addressing the issues of urbanization. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether you want me to touch on the slum upgrading and what we are doing in that.
Yes, yes, okay. We're getting to that in just a bit. Mm-hmm. We're getting to that in just a bit, but just staying a little bit on the policy. Mm-hmm. Now that you're calling for Kenyans to support
yes.
this process and to support government as you undertake these projects, what are some of the issues, just the highlight of the issues that you've given priority in the formulation of the policy?
Okay, the main objective of the National Urban Development Policy is to actually ensure that we have sustainable development in the urban areas and also in the cities. That is the main objective, and that is why in sustainability, we talk about the economy, we talk about the social areas, and we also talk, even politically, we need to address all of those areas. We actually do need political support in spearheading this, yeah? Mm-hmm. Yes, that is generally how we, the kind of things we are covering in the National Urban Development Policy.
Great.
Yes.
Let's move now to the slum mm-hmm. upgrading and take a look at, there was a time just recently, mm-hmm. the cabinet secretary actually presided over the balloting of Soweto houses mm-hmm. in Kibera slums. And there is a report in the dailies this morning that all is up and ready. But then, mm-hmm. just starting with the basics, as far as slum upgrading is concerned, how is this expected to transform the lives or improve the quality of lives of those living in Kibera, as well as improve the scenery around that area?
Again, allow me to start off this one by again addressing legislation.
Yes.
Because if you have development without legislation and policy direction, that can be quite challenging. Mm-hmm. You may end up with just a one-off, because indeed, Soweto Zone A, that's what we call it, is to us, it's really a success story. We witnessed this when we were doing the balloting, because we've had a very, we've guided the process with consultation with the people of Kibera, in consultation even with other stakeholders. And the legislation direction and policy direction we are taking is that very, very recently we've just had the slum upgrading and prevention policy processed. We've already forwarded this to Parliament. It was approved by Cabinet. We have forwarded this to Parliament, and very soon we'll be launching that. Mm-hmm. And again, we cannot do it alone as the government. We do need the people of this nation to honor the policy direction that we are giving in this policy for slum upgrading and prevention. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And okay. Sorry for that. You were saying something?
Yes, you had also said, what is the impact
yes.
of that particular project to the people of Kibera? For one, it is the beginning of a big program that we have for Kibera. We have started off with the 822 units, and we've done it in a very orderly manner, because what we are doing is we agree with them. They move out of the informal settlements. We have developed for them a decanting site where we have a storage building where they move to. When they move there, we come back to the site, we develop that, and then they come in, and then it's a continuous process. In fact, we are also preparing to develop further 3,500 units when now this we have settled the ones who for whom we have finished this program on. The impact for this is, for one, they'll be living in a beautiful environment. I am sure you have already, I believe we've actually been running this in the media to some extent. They are beautiful buildings. We have used the spaces very, very well, because where you had maybe about 200 units, now we've ended up with 832. We have done the landscaping very well. We are even addressing that, addressing the social aspects of living. The grounds are nice. People can sit out there and catch up with what's happening. We also have commercial facilities. Every block actually have a kiosk, and that will assist. We also have stalls. So we are also addressing the economic aspects of the people of Kibera. Mm-hmm. So that is really the impact. And also we are showcasing, even to show the private sector how they also can come in and assist.
Yeah.
So we believe by the maybe in another 8 years or so, we shall have greatly transformed Kibera. And we are not just dealing with Kibera, we are also going to Marigoine. Documentation is well advanced, and we should be getting to Marigoine the very latest, maybe early in the next financial year. Not in the financial year, in the calendar year, mm-hmm. early next year, 2017, we should go to Marigoine and start having the same impact to the people of Marigoine.
Yeah.
And not just that, we also have other programs in other counties. We have a program in Mombasa, a program we call Ziwa Langombe. And there, we are not just dealing with houses. We are also working on the infrastructure, beautiful footpaths. We are also dealing with the floodlights. We are, in fact, there's a very interesting story behind the floodlights. We are told that in the night, children actually go to do their homework under the floodlights. How better can it get?
Yeah.
Yes, indeed. So we are even doing stormwater drainages. We are also doing the sewerages. So we are dealing in this program of in the slum upgrading program. In fact, we have a whole program which has a whole director. We are taking it that seriously. We have a director in the slum upgrading program. We call it KENSAP. We have a director there, and it's a whole program. It's even supported by the we have support from development partners mm-hmm. in that program. Yes.
There was a time this kind of an initiative was launched, but then it didn't quite kick off because there were so many issues in between. There were concerns that people will move into the beautiful house, but then at some point they will move out, go back to the shanties, then lease out the beautiful house to the middle class. Have you addressed this particular loophole?
Yes, indeed we have.
Yes.
Because for one, the people we started off with, we have a master register for the people we started off with, the people who are actually living in those informal structures. Those are the people we've moved along with. We help them to start off circles so that they can actually afford these houses. In fact, it's a very innovative program, yes? We help them start off circles so that when we ask for the deposit, because we are putting in money, it's not really free housing, but it's subsidized housing. In fact, what we have put in is not what, because as a government, we have to come in and support the program. It's not what we are selling those houses for. So we how we have ensured that we don't have that happening is that those same people are the same ones we balloted with. I mean, being people, there are times we've had challenges and we start seeing like that will happen. But even the kind of contracts that we are drawing with them, we are ensuring that that does not happen. Mm-hmm. But also, you know, we can only do so much as a government. We are also depending on the goodwill mm-hmm. of the people who are living there so that we can actually improve their lifestyles. And one different aspect of this program is the people involvement. As we balloted, I don't know whether you picked it, we were actually with the Kenya Human Rights Commission because they understand human rights. They are able, they understand that much better than we would. We are into housing, urban development. Sometimes the human aspects may not quite come through. Mm-hmm. So we are moving with all the stakeholders so that we can get it right.
Right.
Yes, we are, yes.
The cost implication in this one for the people benefiting for the houses, you've said it's highly subsidized. Is it that you're going to hand over these houses to them for free, or do they pay a certain amount at the end of the month? How is that being handled?
My friend, you know, free things, sometimes we don't quite look after them.
Yes.
It's always good to have somebody have a responsibility towards any benefit mm-hmm. that they are getting. So if we did it for free, then people may not value what they have received.
Yes.
So what we are doing, I told you, when we started off, we guided them to start a cooperative. They started the cooperative and they were saving as little as 100 shillings. So as we have done the implementation of the project, they have built up their savings to the extent that they can now pay the deposits. And also, I told you that we have developed commercial facilities. So out of this, and in any case, most of them do have some form of livelihoods. Mm-hmm. It doesn't necessarily need to be formal livelihoods. They have informal livelihoods, and it is expected. And we have actually worked with them and agreed on monthly payments. And we are facilitating them for that I told you we have stalls there.
Yes.
So there'll be business going on. We are not just providing housing, we are actually providing a livelihood.
Exactly.
Yes.
That needed to be very clear, Madam Pierce, because when there was the program of the president giving title deeds at Waitiki and the paying of 1,000, there are people who felt it was too much. But then the president was very clear in saying that you need to pay so that you can have even some sense of pride and ownership.
Absolutely.
And responsibility.
Absolutely.
Over that you have received.
Yes.
So the monthly payment will be how much per month?
Okay, I don't have that one exactly, but we have worked on it from survey that we did to ensure that they are in a position to actually pay.
Yes.
Yes, I don't have the exact figures for now, but it's worked out scientifically, mm-hmm. so that they are in a position to pay.
My next question will mm-hmm. touch on your profession as an architect, because in this country real estate is growing by the day and everyone wants to go into real estate, but then we put up houses only for them to get to a certain point and they come crumbling down. As an architect, where do you feel or where do you believe you're getting it wrong?
I knew this was coming. There's no way we will be before you and you don't ask this.
Yes.
You know, the issue of buildings coming down is not really defined by lack of legislation or people not knowing. There is an element, if I may use this word, an element of impunity mm-hmm. in terms of the developers, the architects, and even the owners, because legislation is there. And even, let's say, to some extent, even the people who are supposed to enforce, we actually need to have everybody in this, the enforcers, the developers, the occupiers, the consultants, that is the architects, the engineers, the quantity surveyors, we need to have an element of responsibility. Mm-hmm. Honoring the legislation that is in place, ensuring that compliance is achieved. Otherwise, we may end up having this. So we are appealing to all the stakeholders in this, whether it be the government who will do the approvals, the developers, the occupiers, that we actually honor mm-hmm. and comply with the legislation that is in place. So we all have a responsibility, mm-hmm. including if I may say so, even you.
Myself?
Yes, we have a responsibility to actually honor legislation as it is. But we are going further. We know the legislation we are using is legislation that has been there for a while, and many things have changed. Maybe by the time we were doing the legislation, the slums were not exactly a challenge. Urbanization may not have been a challenge. The gap between supply and demand for housing may not have been a challenge. Mm-hmm. So now we are actually developing another, as much as I said, there is enough law, but as things change, we still need to update what we are doing to match the emerging issues. So we are developing the building environment law, which shall address all these issues of all these emerging issues. Because by the time the other law was done, we didn't have industrial building systems. So now when we try to put in the industrial building systems, you need to really have to convince the enforcers to allow you to have this. So we need to address the law. We need to address the building code. And this built environment bill is actually addressing this. And we are just finalizing the consultation so that we can now take it to the next level so that it can go to Parliament. We prepare the regulations and start implementing it. Mm-hmm. And we are really looking forward to all of us honoring what we shall provide in the building environment law.
Absolutely. And
yes.
And let's move on to another issue that touches on disaster preparedness. And it's within domain that the government of Kenya, the World Bank, and the government of Austria spending around 160 million mm-hmm. to purchase firefighting equipments for Nairobi and neighboring counties. Is this sufficient? And that's number one. Number two, what else can we do extra to ensure that we enhance our disaster preparedness mechanisms?
Okay, thank you. In this is actually a work in progress.
Yes.
And I keep going back to policy and to policy. Like this, the present program that we have is actually focused along the 2030, the 2030 vision, the Kenyan vision. And what we are doing now is out of a study that was done in 2013, 2014, where we appreciated the areas we need to cover in terms of disaster preparedness. So it's not something like we woke up and decided, oh, there's been a fire, let's go and we need fire engines and all of this.
Nice.
So it's a long-term program, and it's covered, like right now the program we are running is for up to 2017. And we are not just providing that. We are actually doing capacity building. And these fire engines and the equipment, the water boosters, quick response equipment, we are taking them to the counties. This is a program within the Nairobi Metropolitan. So for now, we are actually covering, we are covering the metropolitan region, you know, Kajiado, Nairobi, Murang'a, Kiambu, mm-hmm. and there are five metropolitan regions and Machakos. Yeah, that's what we are covering right now, mm-hmm. and it's covered within the MTP 2, that is the medium-term plan for the Vision 2030. So it's very well positioned in the government programs. And what we are doing with this, we are not just providing that; we are also developing other fire stations. We are also developing, we are also training the people. So far, we have trained over 180 people so that it's not just the people who've always been there addressing the disasters. So we are training. We are also building other capacities for the counties. And on top of that, we are actually speaking to the county governments so that they also build capacity in terms of identifying volunteers, in terms of raising cadets, and in terms of making sure that they are ready for this disaster response.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And information coming from the ministry is that in Kenya, we've got housing demand of around 200,000 units per year against a supply of 50,000 units. How do you intend to bridge this gap?
Okay. Now, one of the priority areas for the government right now, and it's also now domiciled in the State Department of Housing and Urban Development, is the delivery of 300,000 units. And that is not that the government is going to deliver that. It is the government will facilitate the delivery of that. So one of the things we are doing is to bring in the public so that there is public participation in the provision of housing. And we are also addressing the delivery of houses to meet this gap in terms of technology. For one, now we are piloting industrial building systems technology so that we have a quick way of providing housing. Mm-hmm. And we are piloting this with the police housing. We have, right now, we are implementing 1,850 police housing. So as a pilot project, so that we are confident that it will be a success story. After that, once we have piloted this, Kenyans will know that there is technology that is relevant to Kenya and we can take it up. And as we are also encouraging the private sector to be part of this provision, we can pick up that technology and move. And also what we're doing, we know we don't know everything. So we are also partnering with the private sector. We have an incentive right now, mm-hmm. an initiative right now of which we call the Housing Contact Group, where we are calling in all the players in the provision of housing. We have the private developers in it. We actually have the various government departments that would speak into implementation on closing this gap.
Yeah.
And soon we will actually be launching the findings of this team. Mm. And what you're doing, even we also are working on public-private partnerships so that in the government, we only have so much money, so that we can also bring in the finances, which is in the private sector. So we are working on that so that we can improve this demand.
Demand.
Yeah, we also are looking into the kind of figures that we have, because the figures that we have are the ones which what the government is developing and what is coming into the statistics. So we are also working in collecting data because we are convinced that there is much more developed. The supply could actually, and this you can tell from the kind of developments we see all over. As you go towards Mombasa, you will see all those developments at the river and all of this. You take the other direction, you are going towards Nakuru, you'll see all those developments, any direction you take. So these, we are actually confirming. We have a program right now where we are confirming because we have so many incentives that we are giving to the people of this country so that we can all provide this supply of buildings. Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
Looking at the price and the cost of housing, it's just too high. Aida, it's just worrying to some people that if the trend continues like this, we won't afford housing anymore. Is there anything the ministry is doing to make housing a little bit more affordable?
Thank you very much. Again, we are alive to this. And one of the things we are doing, like all over the counties, mm-hmm. we have provided centers where we are building capacity on appropriate building systems, technology. That is one of the ways we are looking into this. I told you about the built environment bill, mm-hmm. where we are putting in conditions that will enable us to use industrial building systems. Mm-hmm. And again, I've indicated that we actually are developing policies that will assist us to have the participation of the people of this nation. Mm-hmm. So in that way, you know, when there are more people participating, we are confident even the prices can actually go down. And with the introduction of the appropriate building technology and also the industrial building systems, and that we should be in a position now to actually bring down the costs of houses. And also, again, we appeal to our professionals the architects, the engineers and all, that they, we also address the way we are designing, because the cost of buildings is a lot informed in the kind of designs that we have. Because if you're going to design houses with a lot of circulation, it's good to have adequate circulation.
Yeah.
But if you're having circulation which is not counting towards the habitation of the unit, then you're having costing that is not helping you mm-hmm. in achieving the kind of costing that you would need.
Right.
Yes.
And in the same, because your response largely also touches on accessibility, how about the circular that was issued about a month ago on the civil servants mortgage scheme? People may wonder, where are the houses and who stands to benefit from the same?
Yes, indeed. We are approaching this from different directions. Direct supply by the government, and also facilitating the civil servants to build their own houses. Mm-hmm. So we do provide mortgage for the civil servants to develop their own housing and then developing ourselves. And right now in Kisumu, we are developing about 250 units. We also have a private-public initiative where we are in the process of working out the implementation, and we want to develop about 10,000 houses. So it's by implementation and also facilitating the civil servants to actually build their own houses. Mm-hmm. So again, here, if a civil servant, when you have a title, and then you can get a facility that will assist you mm-hmm. to develop your own house.
As we bring this to a close, mm-hmm. Let's talk about a spot check around the country that would reveal either incomplete or abandoned civil servant houses. Are there any plans to either rehabilitate or complete those that need to be completed? Or are you going to just hand them over to the county governments to take care of them?
Thank you for that question. Once again, we actually do have a program that started in 2006 to complete the housing projects that you're indicating that are not complete. So we have ongoing work. For example, we have Voi, which is ongoing. We have Kericho Pool Housing, which is ongoing. So there is a government program where the government is actually facilitating the completion of this. Yes, we are addressing the incomplete houses. And soon, we are trusting by 2016, 2017, we should be in a position to complete most of those projects.
Right.
Not most of those projects. We shall complete those projects.
Yeah, great. Yes. Mm-hmm. Completing the project is yes. very, very key. But mm-hmm. probably before I really let you go now,
okay.
Last year, today we expect a State of the Nation address from the President. Last okay. year he did have the same and echoed that his government is committed towards provision of 3 million title deeds by the year 2017. But then you look around, we've got issues of community land that does not really belong to one person, no clear demarcations. How is the ministry going to reconcile all these factors in aid of the president's ambition to issue 3 million title deeds by 2017?
Allow me to really address that as part of the team that is in the Ministry of Land, Housing and Urban Development.
Yes.
We do have a State Department of Lands. And as a ministry as a whole, we are actually zeroing in to make sure that all the emotive issues on land are being addressed. We are working very closely with the National Land Commission so that anything, including the community land, is addressed. But one thing I'm hoping you're doing, I believe you are talking to all of us so that we can tell the people of this Kenya what the government is doing, because the government is doing a lot.
Yes.
So I want to believe very soon you'll actually invite the Principal Secretary of Land so that you can get the very specifics. Right now she's actually addressing the people of this nation in Radio Maisha.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe most likely those are some of the questions she's addressing.
Nice.
So please, for you to get the very specifics, do invite Mariam El Marwi.
For the specifics.
For the very specific.
But you're part of the team.
Yes, I'm part of the team. And
yes.
That's why I said I can indicate generally that we are addressing the emotive issues that,
yes.
That are there for Folans.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Exactly. Yes. I'm looking forward to that, especially if the president does re-echo the same this afternoon and probably get the specifics, as you say, from her. But that has been the principal secretary, housing and urban development. Yes, housing
yes.
and urban yeah. development architect, Aida Munano. She's been bringing us up to speed with those issues that are affecting housing and urban development in this country. We do hope that your questions have been, or at least your issues have been tackled. There are those who are asking about the Kibera upgrading project and whether or not it will be free. But you see, free is expensive.
Absolutely.
Free is yes. expensive eventually. Mm-hmm. So there needs to be that commitment so that you can also have that pride.